If you're able to stand this morning, if you could please stand for the reading of God's Word. Psalms 137, starting with verse 1. Psalms 137, verse 1. And here the Bible says, "By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yea, we wept when we remembered Zion. We hanged our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof. For there they that carried us away captive required of us a song. And they that wasted us required of us mirth, saying, Sing us one of the songs of Zion. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? If I forget thee, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget her cunning. If I do not remember thee, let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth. If I prefer not Jerusalem above my chief joy." Let's pray. Father, thank you for the reading of your word this morning, God, and for what it means. God, we're just asking now for you to anoint us this morning, be able to preach a message. God, it'll do some work in some hearts this morning. God, just apply it to us, Lord, and let it work within us, Lord, and plant a seed and grow from there. Lord, help us today as we preach. Lord, hide me this morning, Lord. Let you be seen. For it's these things I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. Well, this morning, with the help of the Lord, I'd like to bring a message I've entitled Singing in a Strange Land. Singing in a Strange Land. What a scene this opening text has brought us this morning. As we see these Hebrews, as they sat there in Babylon, the land where they've been held captive. And they are sitting there on the banks of the rivers. It may be the Tigris River they're sitting there beside. But they're in Babylon, far away from home. This is not in the godly land where they were promised. Not in the godly land they once lived and they enjoyed and they sung songs of Zion. And they stood and they worshiped God on the hill there on Zion. That's what Zion represents, is God's place. And that's where these people are supposed to be, but they're not. They're not where they're supposed to be. They're in a place that God has allowed them to be because of something that they did in their life. Sin. He warned them before they were taken captive, this is what was going to happen. And now they're reaping what they sowed. As they sowed just distress and destruction and idolatry and evil and sin in their homeland of Jerusalem. Now they're in a foreign land. They're somewhere they don't belong. Verse 1 said, "By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yea, we wept when we remembered Zion." Verse 1 shows them as they remember. Memory is very vivid to us. It brings us sometimes a lot of joy. Sometimes it brings us heartache. But they're sitting there remembering all the good times that they once had. Back when they were in God's will. Back when God was blessing them in the land of Zion. When He gave them everything they needed. As they played on their harps of joy. As they had joy in their heart, as they worshiped and they loved the Lord so much. But sadly, they bowed down to false gods. They worshiped false idols. They defied God's laws. They defiled God's lands. And they denied the Lord their God. And now, look where they're at. They're weeping. They're paying dearly for what they once did. And they're weeping and they're miserable. Does that remind you of anybody today? Does that remind you of any people today? As you look around you in the United States of America, a people that once were blessed by God, that lived godly lives, that once came to church and worshiped, that once had God in their homes, that once read the Bible in their homes, that once prayed in their homes, and now what have they done? They've denied the law. They've defiled the land, and they've denied the very God that allowed them to be blessed as they were. Yes, we are living in the land of captivity today. Many Christians today are in captivity. That's one of the places you don't belong. You do not belong in captivity. You were freed when you accepted Christ as your Savior. You were no longer bound by sin. And all those devices that sin brings, and all the misery and the heartache that sin brought, God took that from you. But you know what? A lot of Christians have continued in their sin. They have continued denying God. They've continued defiling the land. And now they're being held in captivity of sin. Do you know the most miserable person in the world? Do you know who it is? It's not the atheists. The atheists are not the most miserable. The most miserable person in this world is a Christian that is out of fellowship with God. A Christian that has allowed sin in their life and allowed the things of the world to get between them and God. That is the most miserable person in the world. Oh, the atheists can go around laughing and mocking us, and they're not miserable. Not right now. But the Christian out of fellowship, the Christian with sin in their life, they are miserable. They have allowed pressures. They've allowed circumstances. They've allowed lust in their heart, lust for things, desires for things that don't belong to them. If you're a Christian, those things don't belong to you. They're not yours to have. But yet many Christians have clung on to them and held on to them, and now they're strangers in a strange land. Paul writes in Ephesians 5 and 19, he says, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. You know, a Christian out of fellowship with God does not have the same joy that a Christian should have. They don't have a song in their heart when they're out of fellowship. That's what's happened to the children of Israel. That's what happened to these Hebrews as they're in a strange land in captivity. They have no joy in their heart anymore. They have not that joy that God put in there when they once were close to them. And you know what they don't have? They don't have a song in their heart. They can't sing anymore. Their lips have been closed up. They're sealed shut because of sin that they've allowed into their life. What about you this morning? Can you honestly say this morning, can you go along with Paul when he said that you're to speak in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing, making melody in your heart? Is there melody in your heart this morning? Or is there something else in there? Has something took the place of that joy that you once had back when you walked close to God and you had that song in your heart? What's pulled you away from Him? Do you know that laughter and happiness is not joy? Even those most rotten and evil people in this world can laugh. They can be happy, but they don't have joy. It does not require laughter and happiness. It's got nothing to do with that, really. Some people even cover up their sadness with laughter. Proverbs 14 and 17 says, even in laughter the heart is sorrowful, and the end of that mirth is heaviness. No, it's not happiness that brings you joy. It's not being all the pleasures of the world that really bring you joy. You may have a momentary happiness. That's not joy. That's not joy. Money and success, that does not give you joy. You look at the headlines of the news. Look at these Hollywood celebrities, these singers and these movie stars and celebrities that you see gracing the screens of the TVs and the movie theaters and the magazine covers. And we look at them and we say, oh, if I had a life like that, I'd be happy. I'd have joy in my life if I had what they had. If I had their money, I had their fame, their success, and I had all the love of the world that they have, all the fans, and being on a magazine cover, I would have joy in my life if I could be like them. And we have children growing up, teenagers and young people that look up to these celebrities and these singers and stars, and they long to be like them because they've got the twisted, distorted view that the world has gave them, that would bring them joy, that's what they want in their life and need in their life, and that's what true success is. But friends, it's not. That's a warped view of joy. That's not joy. Perhaps you remember back in the 90s, 1996, I still dabbled around a little, listened to country music back then. But back in 1996, there was a country singer. She was number one in the billboards. Number one song, number one album. Sold over 2 million albums of her debut album. She was on the cover of every magazine. She was on all the television screens. They were talking about her on all the radio shows. She was looked up to. People went to her concerts. Sold out. Friends, she had, in the eyes of the world, She was successful. She had it made. I mean, she was living the high life back in 1996, 97, 98, 99. She was on top of the world in country music. She had it made. Maybe you remember in February of last year, hearing on the news of a young lady, 37 years old, Mindy McCready. The one that once stood and sung 10,000 Angels and sold 2 million copies of that song. As she stood on the front porch of her home in Arkansas, took a gun, put it to her head, and blew her brains out on the porch, leaving behind two young boys, a 6-year-old son and a 10-month-old son, who are now in foster care. Yeah, she had it made, didn't she? She had all the success of the world, didn't she? She didn't have joy in her heart. Success and fame and money don't give you joy. It's very apparent. True joy can only come when you're a Christian and when you have the love of God in your heart, when you're walking with Him and you're in fellowship with Him. Then you will have true joy. As long as you're out of fellowship with Him, you can't have peace. You can't have joy, and you can't have a song in your heart. You can't stand and sing like we this morning as that excitement built as we sung, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Were you excited about that this morning? When you sung the lyrics to that song, were you thinking about, boy, He saves? Did you think about the time He saved you when you sung that song? Did you think about all the millions out here in this life that are lost and knowing that the power of Christ can save them? And we sing joyfully, Jesus saves. Usually when I put that in the bulletin, I'll put an explanation point on the end of it. I don't know if Jessica did that this time, but I do that because it's exciting. It brings me joy knowing that. True joy can only come through Jesus Christ in your life. It don't come through the world. It don't come through success in men's eyes. It don't come through your money. It don't come through your bank account. It don't come through a big fancy house you may live in. It don't come through a brand new car. Oh, we'd all like to have a new car with that new car smell, wouldn't we? And then we go in debt and get it. Does that bring you joy? Not really. For a little while you're happy with it, but it doesn't bring you joy. Only Jesus can bring you joy. And as long as you're out of fellowship with Him, you're over in Babylon. You're over in the land of captivity. You're over there with your lips sealed shut, not singing the songs of Zion. That's where you are when you're out of fellowship with Him as a Christian. Verse 2 of our text said, we hanged our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof. Their joy is so far gone, they can't even play on the chief instrument that they had there in Zion. The chief instrument of the children of Israel and the Jews was the harp. Every time that you see the word harp in there, they're playing melodies to the Lord. You may remember King David as he sat there as a young man in front of King Saul. When King Saul, when that wicked evilness would come over him and he would get distraught, and he would call for David to come and play on the harp. What did it do? It played songs of joy, of Zion, of the Lord. And what did it do? It brought him back up. King Saul would get joyous then as that harp was played. But these children here of Israel in the land of captivity, in the land where they've been taken because of their sin, they don't have their harps. They've hung them up in the willows, it says. They don't have the joy in their heart. They can't even play on the instruments. They can't play. It was no accident that they were there. God told them they were going to go there. If you want to turn with me to the book of Jeremiah chapter 25, verse 8. Jeremiah chapter 25 and verse 8. I want you to look at how God had already told them they would be going into captivity. It was no secret. Jeremiah 25 and verse 8. And here the prophet writes, therefore thus saith the Lord of hosts, because ye have not heard my words, behold, I will send and take all the families of the north, saith the Lord, and Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, my servant, and will bring them against this land, and against the inhabitants thereof, and against all these nations round about, and will utterly destroy them, and make them an astonishment and a hissing, and perpetual desolations. Now look closely at verse 10 of Jeremiah 25, verse 10. The Bible says, "Moreover, I will take from them the voice of mirth and the voice of gladness, the voice of the bridegroom and the voice of the bride and the sound of the millstones and the light of the candle. And this whole land shall be a desolation and an astonishment, and these nations shall serve the king of Babylon 70 years. How those words must have played back and forth in their minds as they sat there on the sides of the river in Babylon, weeping over their memories, weeping over all the sin that they've committed, weeping and hanging their harps in the willows out of fellowship with God and knowing it was coming. How they must have wept and mourned. God said, I will take from them their gladness. I will take from them their mirth. These people that He loved so much, He took it from them because of their sin. He took it. If you think for one minute that God won't take your happiness away from you, you better think again. When you're out of fellowship with Him, when you're allowing sin into your life, when you're allowing things into your life that don't belong there, He will take your joy from you. He will take your song from you. And He will put you into captivity. Christians don't belong there. You don't belong there. There's no joy there. There's no gladness there. There's no playing on the harps there. There's no singing the songs of Zion there. It said that they wept when they remembered Zion. Is that you this morning? Do you sit and weep at those days that you remember back when you were close to God? Back when you and Him walked hand in hand? When you could sing that song, Footprints of Jesus, and you meant them. And they meant the words, those words meant something to you. And you sung them with joy from your lips. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. You remember when that song meant something to you? When you sung it, you meant every word of it. But now you look back and you weep. And you don't have a song of joy in your heart anymore. And you're in captivity in this world. And you're in some kind of sin or some kind of problem in your life that's allowed you to come into captivity away from God. And no longer do you have the joy that you used to have. If you're saved today, you should have that joy. You should have had that joy at some point in your life if you've been saved. Psalm 42 and 4 says this, When I remember these things, I pour out my soul in me, for I had gone with the multitude. I went with them to the house of God with a voice of joy and praise, with a multitude that kept holy day. Friends, have you hung your harp in the willows? Are you weeping in the dark places? Do you sit and remember back when you once were close to God and now you're not and you don't know what to do? That's where these people are at. They're in Babylon. They're in that place. That place. I know many Christians today that are in that place. I know people that once walked close to God. You could expect them every Sunday morning, every Sunday night, every Wednesday night, they'd be sitting on the pew. You could just bank on it. You knew they was going to be there. And then something happened in their life and drew them away and into captivity of this world. And their song's gone. Their joy's gone. Their gladness is gone. Their testimony's gone. And look at them. They're slaves now to sin. Verse 3 of our opening text. For there they that carried us away captive required of us a song, and they that wasted us required of us mirth, saying, Sing us one of the songs of Zion. These captives in a strange land are being mocked. They're being ridiculed. They're being made fun of. They're not wanting to hear the songs of Zion from these Hebrews. They don't want to hear God's songs, these Babylonians. They don't want to hear that. You know what they're doing? They're mocking them. They're laughing at them. What about the songs of Zion? I thought you were God's people. Are you not the harp players that stand on the Mount Zion and play your harps and sing to your God? Let's hear those songs of Zion now. That's what they're saying. Yeah, let's hear you sing some of those songs. I'm marching to Zion. Beautiful, beautiful Zion. And that's what the world wants. The world... Satan, he loves to see a Christian when they're out of fellowship with God. He can't touch your soul. He can't touch your eternal destiny. But friends, He can make your life a living hell upon this earth. That's what Satan can do to a Christian out of fellowship. And he loves it. And he mocks you. And he laughs. Sing those songs now. Let's hear you sing, "Jesus Saves Now," Christian. Look where you're at. You're not in God's fellowship. You're out of His fellowship. You don't have a song in your heart. You don't have any joy in you. And the devil laughs, and the world laughs, and they love to see a Christian when they fall. When a Christian falls, they fall hard. Oh, why do you think anytime something happens in the life of a pastor or some religious leader in this world that they flash it all over the news headlines and there's thousands of comments made about it and so many news stories? Why? Because the world loves to see a Christian when they fall. A Christian out of fellowship, and they will mock and they will laugh at you anytime it happens. That's what the devil wants. That's what the world wants. The world hates Highland Baptist Church. They hate every person that belongs here. The world hates us. Why do they hate us? John 15 and 19, Jesus. He says, "If you were of the world, the world would therefore love his own. But because you are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you." Of course they love it when a Christian falls. When a Christian is out of fellowship with God, they delight in it. They rejoice in it. And they just can't wait to rub your nose right in it. Sing us some more of that "Have a Little Talk with Jesus." Sing us some more of that "Jesus Saves." Sing us some more of that "Standing on the Solid Rock." Not so solid now, is it, Christian? And that's what Babylon does to a Christian. That's what the world and Satan does. We don't belong there. That's what's happened to these children of Israel in captivity. They don't belong there. They're being made fun of. They're mocked and ridiculed. And they have no song. They have no joy. They've hung their harps in the willows. And Babylon loves it. Verse 4. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? How sad it is for me to look at a Christian that once stood for God, that once lived a life, a bountiful life. I mean a joyful life. One that people would look at and say, "Boy, I'd like to be like that person." They're always going to church and talking about God. And people looked up to them. And I know some of these people. And then they're out of fellowship. Something happened in their life. Don't know what it was. Could have been a number of things. A lot of them are because of sin. And they've gotten out of God's fellowship. And they have no song. What a tragedy to have no song in your heart. It's no secret that my family is a singing family. I'm on both sides, the Chesneys, the Spencers. We sing. That's what we do. We're singers. God has gave us a gift of song. We've got people that play instruments. We got people that play pianos and guitars and basses and brass instruments. And you name it. We've got music and song in our family. Don't matter which side you go to. I can remember just as a little boy going out to Lorne and Bessie's house just down the road from us. We'd walk down the road and we'd go to their house and we'd go in there and you know what? They had an old piano sitting in the living room. You don't doubt it, friends. By the time the night's over, going to be standing around the piano. Aunt Barbara had been playing on that piano and Lorne would be over there singing that bass. And then we'd have Bessie singing up real high and you'd have Barbara and Brenda singing high. Mom and Daddy, I mean singing. You come to one of the reunions at my house over when my mom has a family reunion, what we do? We start singing. And we get out there and people have different little songs. We form quartets. We have solos. We play instruments. I remember one family reunion, they must have been five or six people playing guitars sitting around. We was all singing and going on. We even taped one of them one time. We were singing. Oh, it don't matter where we at, we sing. Growing up in my home, my family, my mom and dad sung. They always had a song going on in the house. Whether the Chuck Wagon Gang, the Carter family, you name it. Dad playing the guitar, mom singing. One of my sisters playing the piano. We all joined around the piano singing because we had joy in our heart. Joy of the Lord put there. A song that God put there. Oh, and we would sing it. We would sing it. Not long ago, I was down in the fellowship building. And I don't remember who it was, but I was standing behind them, and I must have been singing. And they said, every time I'm around you, you're either singing or humming. And I didn't even realize I was doing it. And friends, God puts joy in your heart. Joy for Him, and you can't help but sing when you're in fellowship with Him. But I want you to know there have been times in my life when I've gotten out of fellowship, and that song's not there. I can't, with an honest heart, stand up and sing those songs of Zion, knowing there's something going on in my life, some sin in my heart. I can't do it. You can't do it. All these songs that are so precious to us. In that old red book, I grew up listening to that old book and singing that old book. Page 57, Amazing Grace. You go on up to 92, have a little talk with Jesus. You go over to 219 and sing Winging My Way Back Home. And in 333, I'll Fly Away. I mean, from front to back, we know it. Because those songs bring us joy. And that's what a Christian should have, is joy in your heart. How sad when you don't. Psalm 32 and 7. It assures us that God puts a song in our heart. He says, Thou art my hiding place. Thou shalt preserve me from trouble. Thou shalt compass me about with songs of deliverance. Selah. And then over in Psalm 40 and 2, he says, He brought me up also out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock, and established my goings. And He hath put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto our God. Many shall see it and fear and shall trust in the Lord. How sad it is when a child of God don't have a song in their heart. You know why? Because He puts one there and He wants you to sing it. What on earth could take away the joy of a Christian? What could take away joy of a Christian? Think about it a minute. What about sorrow? Many people have told me, Brother Byron, you don't understand the kind of life that I've had. You don't understand what I've been through, all the sorrow that's went on in my life. You just don't understand it. Tragedy, and how can I sing? How can I have joy when I've got such sorrow in my life? You just don't understand. Turn with me, if you will, over to the Gospel of Matthew chapter 26 and verse 30. Matthew 26 and 30. You're going to find here in this text where Jesus had just had His Last Supper. He was facing the cross. It was the lowest point in His life as He knew it was coming. He had sat there with His disciples. He had enjoyed the Last Supper with them. He told them of His betrayal. They all cried. They all mourned and wept. They were sad in heart. Jesus was at His very lowest before He would be taken away from that garden and led down, brutally beaten and crucified, and He knew it was coming. Low in sorrow. In Matthew 26 and verse 30, the Bible says, And when they had sung an hymn, they went out in the Mount of Olives. The Lord Jesus, at His lowest point of sorrow, sung a hymn. You want to tell me you're too sorrowful to sing joy to the Lord? You want to tell me there's too much happening in your life to bring you sorrow? Think back on the life of Jesus Christ in His sorrow. What did He do? He sung. He sung a hymn. You know what hymns do? They lift up the name of the Lord because of our joy we have in Him. Even in times of sorrow, a Christian can still have a song of joy in their heart. Joy in knowing the love of the Lord. John 16 and 20, Jesus says, Verily, verily, I say unto you that you shall weep and lament, but the world shall rejoice and you shall be sorrowful, but your sorrow shall be turned into joy. Isn't that wonderful? Oh, He'll take that sorrow from you and turn it into joy. And what can you do? Lift up songs. Lift Him up. Psalm 30 and 5, the last part of it says, Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. Friends, if you're a Christian, God has that joy for you. He wants you to have it. You don't have to be in the captivity, even if you are in sorrow. What about suffering? You know, there's a lot of suffering going on. I've had to see so much suffering in my life. I mean, people that I've loved dearly, as I watched, held their hands while they're sick and dying. Watching people take their last breath, laying in the hospital, dying. in pain and agony, not able to eat for weeks, lost every bit of their weight, lost all their hair, taking chemo treatments. All their bodies are just riddled with pain and suffering. I've stood there with those families at those caskets as they held on to everything they had to be able to stand there and shake hands with people. And they're in sorrow, and they're in so much torment, and they're suffering. They're suffering. Well, over in Acts 16 and 25, you'll find a dynamic duo. You'll find Paul, the apostle. You'll find Silas, his helper, as they were there in that land there in Philippi, as they've been preaching the gospel. And they were accused of things and wrongly, and they were taken and they were beaten. They were beaten badly. And this was no light beating and just tossing into the county pen. This was a beating probably almost to their life's brink. As they're taken to the inner prison there in Philippi, and that old cruel Roman soldier threw them down there and chained their feet to the stocks in the inner part of the prison. As they lay there in pain and agony, with open cuts, bleeding and scabbed over in pain, and laying there not knowing if they're going to survive the night, with all the ugliness that's in a prison like that, they lay there with their feet bound up, and you know what the Bible says? Look at that. Acts 16 and 25, the Bible says, and at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. You want to tell me that you can't sing in your times of suffering? You want to tell me you can't sing in your times of sorrow? Oh, God will put it in your heart. Friends, if you're in fellowship with God, if you're walking with Him, He has that joy in you, that joy, 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 down in your heart. It's there. But as long as you've got sin in your life, as long as you're allowing some of these things to get between you and God, that joy is not there like it should be. And you don't have a song in your lips. What about sin? Sorrow can't take away a true joy of a Christian. Suffering can't take away the true joy of a Christian. There's only one thing that can bring a true Christian out of their joy. Only one thing that can cause your song of joy to be taken from your lips. Only one thing in this world that can cause you to hang up your harp in the willows. That one thing is sin. Sin. S-I-N. One of the greatest examples that you can find in all the entire Bible is in the life of King David. King David, the man, the Bible says, after God's own heart, God loved him. God anointed him as a young man. God used him mightily. Greatest king ever of Israel, King David. He had everything, living in a mighty palace. Had thousands and thousands of men at his beck and call. Had servants. Had anything he wanted to eat, drink. Had it all. And had the love of God. Had joy in his heart. Of all the people in the Bible that sing and lift up praises and sing psalms and hymns, it was David, the young man that would sit on the hillside with the sheep and play the harp. Go down to the king's palace and play the harp for him and soothe him. He had the joy of God in his life. But then something happened. We know the story. He's standing on the top of his palace while all of his men are off in the battlefield fighting. And what does he do? He goes over to the edge and looks over to his neighbor's house. And there's the beautiful wife, Bathsheba. As he has lust in his heart for her. Commands her to be brought to his house. Goes to his room. They have an adulterous affair. He covers it up by lying and having her husband killed. Guilty of murder, guilty of lying, guilty of adultery. Guilt, guilt, guilt. Sin, sin, sin in all of David's life right there. The man that once had joy, that once had a song on his lips, now does not have a song on his lips. His song's been cut off. His lips have been sealed. His heart has been waxed over. He don't have any joy anymore. But what happened? Psalm 51 and 14. David's lost everything right now, his joy, his song. Sin sealed his lips, but in Psalm 51 and 14, he prays and he says, "Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God, thou God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing aloud of thy righteousness. O Lord, open thou my lips, and my mouth shall show forth thy praise." After he had repented and prayed, he said, "God, open my lips, and my lips will sing a song of praise to you." His lips had been sealed because of sin. He said, "My tongue shall sing aloud of thy righteousness." My friend, your sin will cause you to lose your joy. It'll cause you to lose your song. It'll cause you to hang your harp in the willows. It'll cause you sadness as a Christian. It will cause you to be mocked by the world, ridiculed, scorned. It'll cause you to get out of fellowship with God. It'll cause your testimony to be flushed right down the drain. Sin will do that to a Christian. It will lead you into captivity, and it will hold you there in bonds with no song on your heart. It don't have to be that way. God doesn't want His people to be that way. He wants us to have joy. He wants us to have gladness. He wants us to lift up His name in songs. He wants that from you. How can we get it back? Jeremiah 24 and 6. The Bible says, "For I will set mine eyes upon them for good, and I will bring them again to this land, and I will build them and not pull them down, and I will plant them and not pluck them up. I will give them a heart to know me, that I am the Lord, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God, for they shall return unto me with their whole heart." That's what He wants. He wants you to return unto Him. Return back to where you once were, back when He saved you. When you were in His loving care, oh, you're still there, friends, but you've pushed yourself away from Him. As long as you've allowed sin in your life, you've pushed yourself away from God. You've pushed your joy out of your heart. You've sealed your own lips with your sin. But you don't have to remain that way. He says, "Return unto me." Isaiah 55 and 7 says, "Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto the Lord, and He will have mercy upon him, and to our God, for He will abundantly pardon." There is forgiveness from God. All you got to do is say, "Oh God, forgive me of my sins." You know what He does? He forgets them. He throws them. He casts them away. As far as from the east to the west, as to the depths of the sea, never to be remembered again. You know what He does? He brings you right back into that fold, wraps those big loving arms around you, holds you in. And friends, you know what comes out of that? Song. A song of joy in your heart. Joy in your life. Joy of a Christian. Joy in knowing the Lord. Oh, He'll put it back in there. He'll put it back in there. Isaiah 55 and 12 says, "For you shall go out with joy and be led forth with peace. The mountains and the hills shall break forth before you into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands." What about you this morning? Have you lost your joy? Are your lips sealed? Is your song not there? Is there something in your life that's causing your joy not to be there? You don't have to stay in that way. You don't have to keep being that way. He'll give you that joy. He wants to restore it to you. He says, "Return unto me. Return unto me, and I will give you that joy." Oh, can you imagine as you go through life, now filled with the joy of the Lord, putting all those things behind you, that old baggage back there, leave it back there. It's got no place in your life. That's what God wants for you. Would you do that today? As they come and get the invitation song, I want everybody in here today to stand. I want us to pray together. And I want to pray for you. I don't know your heart. I don't know your mind. I don't know what's going on in your life. I don't know if there's sin in your heart or in your life. If there's some problem that's causing you to be into captivity. I don't know you. But God does. You do. And you know if you need to come to Him. As they sing this song, let's pray together this morning. Heavenly Father, I come to you this morning, God, just throwing all this up on you. God, I can't do one more thing with it. God, I've preached your word. God, it's went out. It won't be returned void. God, if there's one in here in this church today, God, that's not got that joy in their heart, Lord, that they need to have, would this be the day, God, that they put off those chains of bondage? God, get out of them stocks. God, return to you, Lord, and restore their joy. Restore that song in their heart. God, is there one today? Lord, is there one or two or three? How many today, God, that needs that joy back in their life? Is there one today? God, have them come down, Lord. Convict their heart, Lord. Show them their need to return to you. God, is there one? As everybody's praying today, as she's singing, if you have a need, would you come down to this altar today and let me pray with you? Would you let me pray with you today if you have a need? Whatever it may be. If you're lost, if you're backslidden, if there's something going on in your life that you can't handle, if you've lost your joy today, would you come down and let me pray with you? Don't go back out this door defeated this morning.